As evolution is increasingly understood by scientists and indeed the general public, the anti-evolution crowd has been shrinking. The watchmaker analogies and banana antics of the past simply don't fare well in the ecosystem that is the age of information. Consequently, those who remain have retreated to ever more esoteric ground. That is, they speak as though they have full knowledge on topics very few people, or in some cases, no one, fully understands. Abiogenesis, the bacterial flagella, or today's subject, DNA.
Tonight's lecture is the Hebrew language, the DNA of creation.
DNA cries out that there's an intelligence behind life.
Scientists have found proof of God in the code of DNA.
Alright, so there's a fair amount to unpack here, but first I extend my deepest gratitude to the renowned biology teacher, John Perry from Stated Clearly, who has very kindly taken the time to help me understand genetics so that I can speak accurately in this video. John is a brilliant science communicator that I've long admired, with his videos on evolution being superbly written and cleanly animated for maximal clarity. What's more, on his second channel, Stated Casually, he's long been responding to concerns and questions from creationists, with this all accumulating with him being one of the most important evolutionary voices on the planet. Truly, it has been an honour to work with this fine ape, and if you haven't yet seen his content, I implore you to find the time. So, to the topic at hand, DNA. Is it really fair to call it a language? And if so, does this language really act as evidence for intelligent design? If you listen to geneticists or read their public-facing articles, you really do find researchers casually referring to the language of DNA. For instance, the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History has an article on human evolution titled DNA, the Language of Life. Other scientists are even applying the tools of linguistics to the study of the human genome. Once you delve into these articles, you quickly see that they never claim that DNA itself is a language. DNA is a molecule. Instead, they point out that this thing that textbooks call the genetic code is surprisingly language-like. The genetic code is a set of rules by which genes, made of either DNA or RNA, code for proteins. And while this code is very different from human languages such as English and Mandarin, if we define language as any method of signal-based communication, then the genetic code certainly fits the bill. In solidarity with many geneticists who are impressed by DNA's linguistic qualities, I will go along with calling DNA, or more specifically the genetic code, a simple form of language. Fair enough. That said, it is important that people recognise the many differences between the genetic code and the spoken word. For a deep dive into this topic, John and I have produced a video on the Stated Casually channel titled The Origin of the Genetic Code, What We Do and Do Not Know. And please do check it out. It was extremely fun and extremely edifying. So then, assuming that we accept that the genetic code qualifies as a simple form of language, is it evidence of God? Well, let's see how creationists are making their case.
You've got to have a language to read the information. And DNA itself has the information that makes the language to read the information. And you know one of the things that we found out? Languages only ever come from an intelligence, and information only ever comes from information. DNA cries out that there's an intelligence behind life. It couldn't have happened by chance random processes. Matter on its own could never produce DNA. But if life evolved, matter had to produce DNA. But that could never happen.
Alrighty. For the sake of clarity, let's put Ham's argument into a syllogism. When Ham says,
languages only ever come from an intelligence,
he's provided us with his first premise, that being that language is always a product of intelligence. And when he says,
DNA cries out that there's an intelligence behind life,
he's provided the second premise, albeit a little disconcerted, that being DNA, or more accurately, the genetic code, is a language. Finally, given these premises, Ham gets his conclusion of the genetic code being a product of intelligence. Now, this argument is, of course, logically valid, since the conclusion follows from the premises, and so the emphasis is on whether or not the premises are sound, whether they are true. Ham defends these premises through analogies, typically referencing Morse code, but before we offer objections, let's witness an implicit presentation of the same argument defended with a similar analogy from John Lennox.
But you see, there's one area where the simple to the complex explanation does not work. And that is the area where language is involved. If you see your name written on Long Beach or something, four or five letters of your name, you infer immediately upwards to an intelligent input. No matter what mechanism put that there, you do that. Now, the fascinating thing, and I often suggest it to my fellow professors, I say, look, you go into your laboratory and you see the DNA with 3.5 billion letters in exactly the right order. And I ask you, what's the origin of that? And you say, chance and necessity. When you'll see anything with language on it, four or five letters, and immediately you say intelligent input.
So Professor Lennox emphasizes that if we saw a few letters written on a beach, we'd infer immediately to an intelligent input. Instantly, we'd recognize the letters, the symbols, as something consciously written by an intelligent being. From here, by way of analogy, Lennox notes that DNA, and by DNA here he actually means the human genome, consists of billions of symbols, of letters, and then expresses incredulity at the fact that his fellow professors do not, like him, immediately infer to an intelligent input. Again, Lennox's argument is implicit, but it's actually precisely the same as Ham's. He's asserting that when it comes to language, we
infer immediately upwards to an intelligent input.
And he then accentuates that the genetic code is a language that consists of many symbols arranged in very specific orders.
And you see the DNA with 3.5 billion letters in exactly the right order.
Okay, so there's the argument, loud and clear. The genetic code is a language, and language only comes from intelligence. Got it. But considering that Lennox's fellow professors are not convinced by this argument, and nor are most professional philosophers, we must ask, what premise do they object to? Well, let's begin by putting some pressure on the first. Consider for a moment another teleological argument, the most famous teleological argument, William Paley's watchmaker analogy. Paley reasoned that if we were to find a pocket watch on the floor, then by virtue of its complexity, we'd immediately recognize it as a product of intelligent design.
Infer immediately upwards to an intelligent input.
From here, by way of analogy, Paley emphasized that every organism, every living thing, is significantly more complex than a pocket watch, and that therefore we know that every organism must have been intelligently designed.
And you see the DNA with 3.5 billion letters in exactly the right order.
Now, I trust that you can see the similarities between Paley's watchmaker analogy, which insists that complexity requires intelligence, and Lennox's beach analogy, which insists that language requires intelligence. Because, in a nutshell, Lennox's analogy is a retreat from Paley's analogy. It's just the next safe space for Jesus. Where once we didn't know how complexity can emerge naturally, we now do. And so proponents of intelligent design have had to retreat to the next God of the gaps, the next God in our scientific knowledge. Now, it's worth noting that Ham rejects evolution by natural selection outright, and that Lennox is extremely skeptical of evolution. But as of today, nearly all scientists, 97%, say that humans and other living things have evolved over time. Hence, 97% of scientists reject Paley's watchmaker analogy. But here's the key takeaway. Before Darwin, we didn't have an empirically substantive answer to Paley's analogy. When Paley insisted that we must conclude that organisms, with all their complexity, are intelligently designed, this seemed convincing to many of his contemporaries because evolution by natural selection had not yet been known. But today, of course, we bask in the light of Darwin, and so we can clearly see that Paley's analogy is nothing more than an appeal to ignorance fallacy. He asserted that the proposition of complexity emerging naturally must be false, since we didn't know, in his time, of any complex things emerging naturally. Now, don't be fooled, my fellow apes, the DNA argument is really nothing new. It's yet another appeal to ignorance fallacy. No one currently knows how language naturally arises, therefore language cannot naturally arise. Or, the proposition of language emerging naturally hasn't been demonstrated to be true, therefore it's false. This, I hope you can see, is every bit as fallacious, illogical, and unreasonable as when Paley insisted that complexity can only come from intelligent design. Thus, the only refuge that the genetic code can offer theists is the fact that we don't yet know where it came from in the first place. Right now, language might seem like a safe space for Jesus, but do you really want to repeat the errors of our ancestors by basing your faith on, I must say, an obvious appeal to ignorance? Oops, I forgot to turn my phone off before recording. That is a bit embarrassing, but wouldn't you know, this is John Perry. That's the guy I was telling you about earlier that's helped me with, well, pretty much the whole video. So we'll answer this. Hey, John.
Steven, brother. Look, I'm sorry to break the fourth wall here. Great presentation. I'm loving it so far. But did you just say that language is a safe space for Jesus?
No, I said that language might seem like a safe space for Jesus for now, but who knows when science will catch up. You know, like, eventually it will close the gap, I assume.
Look, I appreciate what you're trying to do here, okay? I've read the Bible. People were really mean to that guy. If anyone deserves a safe space, I'm sure it's Jesus. But language is not the safe space that Ken Ham and John Lennox seem to think it is.
Wait a minute. Are you saying that scientists already figured out how exactly the genetic code emerged?
Exactly how it emerged, no. Lots of details remain a mystery, but rapid progress is being made on that front. Most importantly here, though, we already understand in principle how simple languages like the genetic code come about. Language can be the product of a mind, as Ken Ham says, but language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution.
Now that is interesting. Language can emerge through the process of co-evolution.
Yeah, correct. If Ken Ham and John Lennox want to be honest men, if they want to, they will need to modify their first premise. Do you mind if I explain?
Yeah, dude, please do. I mean, who better to explain than the man who literally works with geneticists and origin of life researchers? Guys, I give you John Perry from Stated Clearly.
Well, all right. Hello, my fellow apes. As Stephen mentioned, there is what some people are calling a language at the heart of biology. Scientists usually call it the genetic code. It's this thing right here. Let me stress again that this code is incredibly simple compared to human languages like English, but still, how on earth did even a simple language end up inside ourselves? What even are we? Well, it turns out that biology is filled with what you could call simple languages. To avoid confusion with human languages, biologists usually call them codes or signaling systems. For some reason, the word gets two L's when British scientists write about it. But no matter how you choose to spell it, biological signaling systems allow communication between different biological entities. You have senders and you have receivers. A sender and a receiver might be two individuals from the same species. Birds vocalize to warn off rivals and to attract mates, for example. Here, the sender and receiver both happen to have thinking minds, and, like us, they communicate with vocalizations. But thinking brains are not always needed for communication, and signals do not need to be sounds. Senders and receivers might be individuals from different species. Plants, even though they don't have thinking brains or voice boxes, really do send signals to bees, butterflies, and all sorts of pollinators. As I'm sure you are all aware, flowers are a plant's sex organs. Something fun to think about next time you stop to smell the roses. But flowers are also signaling structures. They're like little billboards saying, "Hello, critters, come pollinate me." Their enhanced colors, shapes, and fragrances evolved under selection pressure to communicate with pollinators. In other cases, senders and receivers might be large groups of organisms. Individuals within groups of bacteria send out molecular signals to their kin all the time. This allows them to coordinate group behaviors, a phenomenon called quorum sensing. Senders and receivers might be different tissues within the same body. Our hormone or endocrine system is an intertissue chemical signaling system. A lion cub's fur, for example, before puberty, has the potential to develop down either a male or a female pathway. If an individual happens to have testicles, those testicles will make testosterone molecules during puberty, which spread through the bloodstream along with other hormones, other signaling molecules. When those hormones connect with special receptors inside the cells of hair follicles, the lion begins to grow his mane. It's not too unscientific to say that a lion's balls are talking to his hair. Glorious. Finally, senders and receivers might be two different structures inside of a single cell. The genetic code represents this type of signaling system. Now, DNA doesn't actually have letters in it, as John Lennox seems to have been suggesting.
And you see, the DNA with 3.5 billion letters in exactly the right order.
Instead, DNA is made of nucleotides. Nucleotides are molecules. There are four different types, and scientists have labeled them with letters. That said, the genetic code really is a chemical signaling system. Genes, usually made of DNA, transmit chains of messenger RNA to special structures called ribosomes. Ribosomes are protein-building complexes. They interpret every three nucleotides in a messenger RNA as a signal, signals we call codons. Ribosomes build specific proteins according to the instructions, the sequence of codons in the chain of messenger RNA. Genes really do communicate with ribosomes. What do they communicate about? Well, genes tell ribosomes how to build specific types of protein. Creationists are in awe of these communication systems, and I do not blame them. These things are absolutely fascinating. So fascinating, in fact, that I have dedicated a huge chunk of my career to helping teach other people how these communication systems work. I absolutely love them. And I do understand why creationists think that these communication systems might be some sort of evidence for God. Each signal, whether it be a codon in DNA or the pigment in a flower, it means something specific to the receiver. It has a meaning that does not exist outside that communication system, a meaning that somehow needed to be assigned to its signal. Something truly special really is happening here. Signals aren't simply assigned their meanings by the cold laws of physics, not the cold laws of physics alone. Creationists are completely wrong, however, when they insist that a signal can only be assigned a meaning by an intelligent mind. Language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution. If you only remember one thing from the day that John Perry commandeered the YouTube channel of Rationality Rules, let it be that language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution. So, what do I even mean by that? Well, when two or more evolving entities, that could be individual organisms, individual genes, are under selection pressure to cooperate, cues can be transformed into signals. Meaning can be naturally assigned. Now, it's probably still not clear what it is that I'm saying here. Let me give you an example that's a little bit more familiar to most people than genetics. Let's look at how signaling emerges in flowers, in plants. Again, flowers are a plant's sex organs. Pollen grains contain plant sperm cells, which can fertilize the egg cells, the seeds, of neighboring plants. Many plant species simply count on the wind to spread their pollen to neighboring plants. And in fact, if you suffer from allergies in the springtime, the reason for that is because you have been breathing in too much plant sperm. So, another lovely thought for you. Pollen, it turns out, is loaded with nutritious protein. Because of this, all sorts of bugs and small animals have evolved to seek out plants that are producing pollen so that they can eat that pollen. Here we are looking at a cycad plant, sometimes pronounced cycad. Cycads have not evolved flowers. Instead, they still produce pollen and seeds inside pinecone-like structures. The first true flowers evolved from structures fairly similar to these cones. This cycad cone is absolutely infested with pollen-eating beetles. Early on in the cycad-beetle relationship, an infestation like this would have been horrible news for the plant. But once a plant population has been targeted by pollen predators for several generations, adaptations begin to take hold. Any random mutation that makes pollen occasionally stick to the body of a pollen predator will end up being favored by natural selection. This is because pollen predators visit many plants while feeding. In the process, they accidentally bring uneaten pollen directly to those plants, triggering fertilization. Here we have the start of a co-evolution process. As bugs evolve to become better and better at finding pollen, plants evolve pollen that is better and better at hitching a ride on those bugs. Eventually, there might come a point where insect pollination is actually more efficient than wind pollination. When you think about it, it's not that difficult to reach that point because wind pollination is extremely sloppy. It just, the pollen goes everywhere. So even if you do have predators that are eating a lot of pollen in the process of pollinating, well, that's okay. You're sacrificing some grains of pollen, but not nearly as much as you would be sacrificing to the wind. A typical insect will use visual cues, plus what you could call their sense of smell, to find pollen-producing plants. These smells, the colors, the specific shapes of leaves that happen to have been associated with pollen in the past, those are the cues that an insect looks for when hunting for pollen. Any random mutation a plant has that happens to magnify any one of those cues, transforming those cues into signals, that mutation will help an insect find the plant sooner. The faster a plant is found, the more other plants it will pollinate, the more offspring it will have. Over just a few generations, that new mutation will spread all throughout the plant population. At this point, an evolutionary arms race has begun between plants. Who can signal the loudest? The race is on. Modern cycads have already reached the point where they benefit from pollen predators. While they have not yet evolved anything we'd want to call a true flower, they have evolved brightly colored pine cones, which beetles can see from a long distance away. They've also evolved strong-smelling molecules, which they release into the air when pollen is ready. The stench is somewhat foul to our noses, but heavenly for these little beetles. True flowers and their languages can be extremely complex. Language complexity depends on the species, but flowers can send many different types of messages to their pollinators. These include specific signals for when pollen is ready, whether or not nectar is also available, and some species have even evolved signals that warn pollinators if they've already been pollinated and will no longer be providing treats.
Languages only ever come from an intelligence.
Sorry, Ken, but you do need to rewrite your syllogism. Language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution. For details on what we do and do not know about the origin of the genetic code specifically, check out the video that Stephen and I did on the Stated Casually channel, The Origin of the Genetic Code. In short, the code likely emerged as primitive genes and primitive ribosomes co-evolved to cooperate in the production of proteins, much like flower signals emerged as insects and plants co-evolved to cooperate in pollination. Again, language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution. Back to you, Stephen.
So there you have it. Language can also emerge through the process of co-evolution. In summary, then, at first glance, it seems that the claim that the genetic code is evidence of God is nothing more than an appeal to ignorance, a classic God of the Gaps argument. Digging a little deeper, however, we find that things are worse still. Back in Paley's day, no one knew how complexity could naturally arise. His argument was founded on a genuine gap in human knowledge at the time. In contrast, even though many details about the origin of the genetic code remain mysterious, we do know, in principle, how simple languages like the genetic code naturally arise. Given this, the gap that is the origin of the genetic code isn't quite the five-star hotel that creationists seem to think. It's more of a beaten down motel. Anyhow, please do check out the collab that John and I did on Stated Casually. John dropped some really damn interesting facts, and I'm also there. As always, thank you kindly for the view, and an extra special thank you to my wonderful patrons and YouTube members. If you fancy getting your very own debunked cartoon, or even a tankard of truth, be sure to take a look at either Patreon or YouTube members. Much love all.